My guest is a relentless and passionate animal welfare campaigner. And he's been here before many times on Latest TV, but today he's here with a little bit of a difference because Marc Abraham is Marc Abraham OBE. Congratulations,
that's,
Marc.
I think, the first time I've heard it out loud.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm honored.
Yeah, it's
well,
very
I'm
new.
Honored anyway to have you with really, really the fantastic work that you've been doing, and you've been very rightly and deservedly awarded.
Yeah, it's very, I don't know, privileged, blown away to be recognised. It's a great feeling. But it really is, it's really to shine a light on all the work that grassroots campaigners are doing with the minimal resources they have available.
Absolutely.
To help change public behaviour, raise awareness, maybe even change the law, all three. And I hope it encourages people to realise that the tools are there, e-petitions, meeting your MP, social media, to change the world for the better.
So just before we're talking, we talk about the changing the world for the better, for the very, very few who don't know you, haven't heard of Marc the Vet,
or those lucky people out there.
The dog father, that's a good one, isn't
it? That came, I don't know where that came from. But yeah, Kay Burley seems to be using that a lot on Sky News now,
which I'll take. Very apt.
Yeah.
So give me a quick resume of your campaign. What have you been
campaigning for? So I'm a vet.
You're a vet.
In Brighton. And about 12 years ago, I saw puppies dying of a disease which is commonly found on puppy farms. And I started to campaign against that, to try and change that. I didn't have any idea about politics or law. So I started with a dog show, which was judged by sort of celebrities and personalities, which actually started in Brighton, Stanmer. And then I moved it to London, and I raised awareness that way. And then I started to go to Westminster, thanks to Caroline Lucas, Brighton Green MP. And then about 300 visits later, on every day off while I was being a vet down here, we managed to change the law, which bans the third-party commercial sale of puppies and kittens.
And that's called Lucy's Law, named after
a little Cavalier King Charles Spaniel called Lucy. And that means that everyone who wants a dog has to go either direct to the breeder or to a rescue shelter. So there's no pet shop selling puppies anymore. And that law is coming in England. It's coming in September in Wales and Scotland. Northern Ireland, it's being written. And then since the beginning of lockdown, I've started and almost finished campaigning for another law to change, which is to ban the import of young puppies under 6 months from overseas puppy farms. So the only dogs that can come in are obviously dogs that are older than that.
Because what happens if they do come at that young age?
What's the problem with that? Traumatic journeys, separated from mum too early, inadequate rabies protection, which means our country is at risk, animals and humans. Puppy smuggling is enabled by legal imports of young puppies. So there's loads of, and enforcement as well is impossible with the current laws because it's 15 weeks and you cannot age, even vets can't age accurately a puppy that's 15 weeks from their teeth.
Right.
So 6 months, the secondary teeth are through, and it's the first thing that cannot be changed, or the only thing that can't be falsified, and the first time the secondary teeth come through, the adult teeth.
So, and is this law definitely going, the second law, is that definitely
going? So the government have now promised and put in primary legislation that the increase is going to happen, and secondary legislation will be the exact age, which we hope, assume, it's not just myself fighting for it, it's other animal welfare organisations, is going to be the 6 month thing as well. And I think when that happens, that's five laws changed. It's amazing because in 2013, when I started campaigning, 2009, no idea about politics, 2013 started to get into politics, and now 2021, you know, changing five laws, sourcing the rescue dog for the Prime Minister and his now wife, Carrie. So it's amazing how that curve has happened so quickly.
And it is interesting, isn't it? Because you mentioned politics. I mean, you know, it's the well-being of the animals that is your priority. But you've had to become a politician of sorts, you know, to schmooze politicians, to knock on doors, to fight, to campaign. It's not always as glamorous as the end result of, or not the end result, but receiving an OBE. And I've realised that you've dedicated the OBE to your, primarily to your family, as well as to the campaigners and to the pets themselves. Tell me just briefly, what's the significance of your family? What has that been in the process?
Well, I lost my dad 5 years ago, and he was in advertising. And advertising and parliamentary campaigning are actually very close not career moves, because I wouldn't consider mine a career. It doesn't actually pay any money. But you're sort of reaching the masses, using creativity, and you're getting them to do something. In advertising, it's byproduct. In campaigning, it's usually sign and share a petition or contact your MP or some sort of call to action. And we never really had that chat about how close our careers were in terms of what it entailed. Grandma sadly passed away 2 months ago. She was an inspiration, just over 100, inspiration, because she was a Holocaust survivor. She escaped the Holocaust and taught me that anything's possible and to never give up. And then, of course, little Lucy is also part of the dedicated trio because she inspired the whole campaign and was an incredible dog. So there's that. I want to, you know, as I said earlier, shine a light on the grassroots campaigning and what can be achieved knowing nothing about the system just by collaborating, working together and using the tools available. And as you say, it's not all glamour. I mean, 98% of campaigning is hard work. You know, it's a leader campaign. It's lonely. It's depressing. It's tough. You constantly face barriers. Sometimes you never know why they've happened, the obstructions, until maybe 3 or 4 years later. But you just got to keep going and look after your mental health. And I think living in Brighton is the perfect place to live if you are thinking about being a campaigner, because you've got the horizon and the downs and swimming in the sea and so many opportunities to let your brain decompress and come up with new stuff. Funny enough, going to the Amex and watching Brighton is where a lot of ideas come to me, because your brain is finally in a relaxed state, depending on the score, obviously. So yeah, loads has happened in the last few years, and I can't thank, obviously, yourself and Latest TV for all their support and all the viewers' support as well, all fans of Latest TV, all Brighton residents, all Brighton pet lovers, because everyone has played a part in making change happen for the animals, and I'm very proud of it.
Oh, and we're very, very proud of you. Mark, keep in touch,
of course,
let us know what's happening with future endeavours, and thank you so much for coming to the studio.
Thanks, Yael. Appreciate it.